There's a problem. Actually, it's the other way around. It's people that are the problem. If the camps run badly and food scraps are left around, bears come in and become habituated. They get used to taking scraps or even gifts of food from people. And when bears and people come into close proximity, obviously, at some point, there's going to be a problem. Usually, it's the bear that ends up the one being hurt. Fortunately, at this campsite, I'm lucky because I can use this bear box to store my food, and you can see it's built like Fort Knox. It's actually a regulation that your food must be secured away from bears, either in a box like this or suspended from a tree.
You won't always have access to a bear box, but there's a fairly easy way to store your food if not. Bushcraft is all about being adaptable. I learnt this technique of throwing a rope into a tree from a tree surgeon, and it works perfectly for this purpose. The most important thing to remember, though, is to seal your food in airtight bags to conceal its scent before you suspend the bags in the tree. If the bears can't smell your food, the chances are they'll steer clear of your camp.
Well, that's me done. I've just got one last job to do, and that's to light a fire. I only need a small fire just to make brews and to keep me warm, and I'm going to set that up underneath the tarp. If I protect the fire from the rain, it uses less fuel, and less fuel means less work. What I'm collecting are these. You see where the branch of this old pine goes into the stump? It's what you call a pine knot. These are full of resin. When you sniff them, you can smell it. If you put those on the fire, they burn brightly and give you a good blaze. These are exactly the sort of skills that Jim Bridger would have had to use. Staying up here for months on end, candles would have been a precious commodity. If you want light to work by in your cabin at night, pine knots were the old-time solution. A few of these on the fire gives you a bright blaze. And now, as the sun's going down, this is the perfect time to use them. They'll give me a lot of light here. Also, they're very slow burning. They're very reliable fuel, particularly if it's been raining. The spluttering flames on the pine knots is a really comforting sight. They're a fascinating thing. The last time I came across anybody else using pine knots was in Canada. I was travelling down a river, and at the campsites, when I got to each campsite, I found pine knots that had been collected and left by the fireplace. Now, this isn't something you see every day. This piece of bushcraft is one of those bits that are being forgotten. And I was intrigued by this. I never did catch up with the people who left those pine knots there. But it was interesting, there was a bond there between people who knew a similar resource. But at the end of my journey, I made a few inquiries to find out who else had been down the river recently. And it turns out that it was a group of Indians, native Canadians, who'd gone down the river to teach youngsters how to live in the bush. And one of them was using this skill.
Bridger lived out here for months at a time. Apparently, he hated going to town. He found the beds too soft, and if he had to stay in a hotel, he'd sleep on the floor instead. This is just how he must have felt. Out in the wilds, not knowing what tomorrow might bring. In mountain meadows, mornings are beautifully still and quiet. But not today. 200 meters from my camp, there are dark shapes moving. This is a pack of wolves, known as the Washakie Pack. Although this has been part of their territory for 8 years, this is the first time that Tori has ever seen them.
Now, in all the time I've spent outdoors, I've seen plenty of tracks of wolves. I even saw a fresh dropping yesterday. But to see the animals themselves, well, they're very secretive. You can count those experiences on one hand. So that was a marvellous sight. And what I intend to do is, once I've had some breakfast, I'm going to saddle up, ride out over there and see what tracks they've left behind. I can't wait.
Tracking on horseback provides a unique vantage point. From just these extra few feet above the ground, you gain a bird's eye view of the animal's movements.
I can see where they drag bits over that way as well. Some more bone back there, coming this way. There's the rear pad. So they must have made the kill somewhere near here. There's a lot of disturbance here. Tori, how many wolves are there in this area?
We saw six this morning, and I think the pack is not much larger than that. There's been a few killed by control actions the last few weeks. At least four have died by the actions of the government.
So how do you feel about that?
To kill the wolf just because he's doing what he does naturally by feeding on different things, in this case a calf elk, but in that case down there a domestic cow, I don't necessarily agree with that. To bring them back into the greater Yellowstone ecosystem, as we have done here, is a tremendous success story, and it is going to take give and take on everyone's part, but four wolves for the price of one cow, it seems a little excessive to me.
Yeah, I think I'd agree with you. Whoa. I don't know whether you can see that, but down there, that is not a dog dropping. That's a dropping from the wolves. We followed the trail that they left all the way from the kill site up to here. And I can see further very fine disturbances coming up the slope here. There's some scuffing there, and they've gone up this way. These animals really are magical. If only you had more wild places for them.
I can't believe how lucky we've been to see these wolves. To me, the wolf is the ultimate symbol of the wild. To see them prospering in their habitat gives me real hope.
I'm really impressed with these horses and their ability to negotiate this incredible terrain. But I can't imagine how difficult it would be to bring a horse and cart through here. The real secret to finding a way through these mountains lay with the native inhabitants.
Jim Bridger's close ties with the many Indian tribes who lived across this land were crucial when it came to pioneering a road to the west. From their unsurpassed knowledge of bushcraft, he learned the techniques that he needed to overcome the many obstacles in his way. There are thousands of kilometers of rivers to negotiate.
The local way to travel down rivers or across them was using something called a bull boat, which is the North American equivalent of a coracle. And for the hull, the covering of it, what they used was this, a buffalo skin. Fresh buffalo hide like that. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make a bull boat and see how they are in the water. First job is to lay this out and gauge the size of the boat.
You have to be adaptable, using wood that is locally available. Willows grow abundantly on this riverbank. These stakes mark out how big the frame will be.
I can move this hide out of the way now.
put that in the shade somewhere.
And now I can start to construct the boat itself. For that, the first